The early 70s saw some interesting changes. Belly boards became known as knee boards, but they were exactly the same. Shorter and lighter surfboards attracted more girls to the sport. Also, the leg rope was born. Skateboards of a more sophisticated design rolled back into fashion. Flared jeans were in. And the best surf movie of the day was The Morning of the Earth.
The forces of the universe and the elements of space conjured up your being, your size, your time, your shape. You were created with all the beauty they could call. And Earth is surely the measure of them all. Your rocks all turn to gold and your tiny stones to jewels. And when the swirling mists had cleared, you stood so pure.
The Morning of the Earth captured the feelings of the period with an emphasis on the alternative lifestyles, the taking of psychedelic drugs and letting tomorrow's problems take care of themselves. It was an approach to life that appealed to nearly every surfer, including the talented Keith Paul. It was difficult for Keith to give up this laid-back existence, and he would not figure in surfing's next development. Most Aussie surfers were into flower power, country soul, and the euphoria of riding the waves. A brigade of younger surfers totally committed themselves to competition. Narrabeen in Sydney was the center of this new thrust. Terry Fitzgerald was the driving force.
That late 60s, you know, it was all escape, get away, who wants to be regimented, Vietnam, all that stuff. So it was really easy to go surfing because essentially, you were just getting away from what everybody wanted to do to your head or your brain or your body in Vietnam. Mm. That escape formula that grew in the late 60s was the cause of the surfing revolution in the early 70s. We supplemented the competitive arena with the club and used club contests every month or you know, inter-club contests bi-monthly. We just took on a competitive, you know, like all those guys, Grant Oliver, Mark Warren, Young Simon, Cole Smith. It was a situation of, you know, we're 18, 19, 20, 21. Our egos had to build each other about a bit, so we did it with club contests.
This really paid off. The Narrabeen boys made up the majority of the Australian team for the 72 World Contest in California. Doug Warbrick went to San Diego as a judge.
And on the way back, I spent a bit of time in Hawaii and saw the first fully blown pro events. I thought that was a great idea. In Easter 73, which was a couple of months after the events in Hawaii, we saddled up with the first fully blown pro event in Australia.
Bell's Beach in Victoria proved to be the perfect venue. The Easter weekend guaranteed good crowds from Melbourne who had ready-made vantage points. Sponsors were not hard to find. Many top surfers were already being supplied with boards and a few dollars. The manufacturing companies were now getting keen to align themselves with the stars. Professional surfing was catching on. My Michael Peterson from Queensland's Gold Coast won the Bells Beach contest. He literally burst on the scene. During 1973, 74 and 75, he won every major event he entered. Although Peterson didn't go to Hawaii that year, most of Australia's hot young surfers did. Ever since the early 60s, Australian surfers made the pilgrimage to Hawaii to ride the biggest waves in the world. The 1976 Smirnoff Pro-Am was a memorable contest. It was battled out in 25-foot waves. When the results were announced, Australians Mark Richards, Ian Cairns, and Rabbit Bartholomew were placed first, second, and third, respectively. Cairns, who remembers this wave only too well, was determined to make a career out of professional surfing. Originally from Perth, he spent most of his time traveling. It was Cairns, his close friend Peter Townend, and another talented surfer, Mark Warren, who formed a promotional team that would go in search of fame and fortune. They called themselves the Bronzed Aussies.
It works out really good, you know, like we really encourage each other and support each other, and we're in there wanting one of us to win, you know, because as a team, if one wins an event, well, it's beneficial to the three of us, and that's one of the main reasons we formed the Bronzed Aussies.
This was a difficult time for the new breed of so-called professional surfers. All they could expect to receive for their performances was an airfare and expenses. What was obviously needed were bigger cash prizes and a change in the judging system. Such moves would make the sport more professional and more appealing to the public. One Australian did just that, single-handedly. Peter Druin was the oldest pro surfer on the circuit in the mid-70s. Druin, who hails from the Gold Coast, learned his surfing in that unique area which has been a surfer's paradise for 30 years. The numerous headlands there include three of the finest point breaks in the world, Greenmount, Kira, and Burleigh Heads. Every year, between December and April, cyclonic conditions create quality waves. Armed with this local knowledge, Druin set about staging a contest. He persuaded a large Queensland sportswear company to sponsor the 1977 Stubbies at Burleigh Heads. The world's biggest surfing prizes were up for grabs. Druin also introduced his man-on-man judging concept. This method became generally accepted and is still with us today. I'm tired of the city life. Summer's on the run. People tell me I should stay, but I got to get my fun. So don't try and hold me back. Ain't nothing you can say. As its very name suggested, man on man allowed only two men in the circle.